Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Remembrance Sunday service from Ashley Baptist Church.
Meekness and majesty, manhood and deity, in perfect harmony.
Our service of remembrance today, and as well as John preaching, we'll be sharing communion too, so do get your bread and wine or juice ready. I'm sorry we're not able to use our building now because of the new restrictions, so there will be no reflective services for this coming month. Do watch the 4-minute online stories for the children at 9:45 on a Sunday morning. They're really lovely. We have a church members meeting on Zoom on the 19th, Thursday the 19th of November. We're having our AGM as well as an ordinary meeting, and you should have received some documents by email or by post. Also the voting slips for the diaconate. If you haven't received them, please do let the office know. And finally, last week we had that lovely interview which Laurent did with Pastor Soitio in Plovdiv and with Nedco interpreting. Every year we like to give generously to the Plovdiv Winter Fuel Appeal for those who really suffer in the winter months in Bulgaria. Please do give generously, and you can give online or else sending a cheque into the office address written out to Ashley Baptist Church. Thank you. And now let's pray. We thank you, Lord. We're your body, and we are here together to celebrate, to worship you, and also to remember those who've given their lives so sacrificially in the world wars and since then too. And Lord, we ask you that you'll help us through this time. Help us to focus on you, to worship you in all that's going on. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
This morning's reading is taken from John chapter 15. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Amen.
Remembrance Sunday, a day where we remember those who gave their lives in the wars so that we as a country could live in freedom. But today we also remember Jesus. Jesus who gave his life on a cross for you and for me. And to help us to remember this, I want us to look at the poppy. Now, after the First World War, when the land and the fields had been churned up by the fighting, the poppies were the first thing to start to grow back. And if you look at your poppy, it's made up of three parts: black, red and green. The black part can remind us of the war. and all the bad things that are in our world, the darkness, and the Bible calls this sin. And in your life, that might be lying. It might be stealing. It might be cheating. It might be saying horrible things about people. The list goes on and on. But we all do bad things. The red part of our poppy can remind us of the blood that was shed in the war. It can also remind us that Jesus shed his blood on the cross when he died for you and for me. Jesus went to the cross because he loved us. The red part is so much bigger than the black part on our poppy. And that reminds us that love is so much more powerful than sin and darkness. The green part of our poppy, the stem and the leaf, reminds us that things can grow. And when we know Jesus, when we love Jesus, we can grow to be like him. And when we're like Jesus, we can learn to love others. Now, we are very lucky that most of us will never be asked to go to war. Most of us will never be asked to love someone that much that you're asked to give your own life up for them. Jesus gave his life for us because he loved us. We too can be like Jesus and love others. And we can do this by being kind. We can do this by looking out for each other. We can do this by helping those that nobody else wants to help. We can show Jesus's love in the way in which we behave. Whether that's at school, whether that's at college, your place of work, or just in your street or your road where you live. There's darkness in the world. The Bible calls it sin. But Jesus's love overpowers that darkness. And because of the blood that was shed on the cross, we can be forgiven for the wrong things that we do. And we can grow to be like Jesus, to love others as Jesus loved us. Let's pray. Lord, we are thankful and we are grateful for those who served in the war and gave their lives so that we might live in a better country, a country with freedom. And Lord Jesus, we thank you that you sent your Son so that we could be free from sin, that we could live a life full of love. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you help us to grow, to be more like you. Lord, help us this week to show your love to the people that we meet. Help us to be kind. Help us to help one another. Help us not to judge. And help us to just love those around us, even when that seems really hard to do. Thank you, Lord, for the love that you have for us. Amen.
I lift your name on high.
to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
Good morning, everybody. It is an absolute privilege to be sharing from God's word with you today on Remembrance Sunday. I want to ask you, when you were at school, did you go on many school trips? Do you remember any of them? What was your favourite one? Well, for me, the favourite school trip, the best school trip, and then in many ways the worst school trip at the same time, was when I went on a coach trip to Germany and Poland. I was 16 years old, there was about, I don't know, 40 or 50 of us, and we went on this historical trip visiting various sites. We went to Berlin, where we saw the Berlin Wall, went to the Reichstag, and went to various places. And I remember when we travelled down from Berlin, going to Poland, we got to the border. And, you know, the teachers were always saying, make sure you got your passports, make sure you got your passports. And this was a time when you needed your passport. And there was one kid at the border of Poland who said, I haven't got my passport. And so a teacher and this student, it wasn't me, had to get onto a train, travel for 5 hours back to Berlin to find the passport in the kid's hotel room. And then get the train all the way back down to Poland to try and meet us. And it just shows how easy it is to forget things, important things, isn't it? But the most poignant and powerful stop of that trip was when we went to Auschwitz. We visited that concentration camp that was used in World War II to kill over 1 million people. There's two sites at Auschwitz. There's Auschwitz 1 and Auschwitz 2, or otherwise known as Auschwitz-Birkenau. And I want to try and paint a picture of what it was like when I visited that place. Well, first of all, the thing I remember is the heavy snow. We went in January time and it was just covered in snow. And it reminded me of those stories that I'd heard of people who were at Auschwitz being made to work in the snow with no shoes, barefoot. So even just the weather was harrowing for me. And I remember walking through those taunting gates that read, Arbeit macht frei. Work means freedom. Work sets you free. The biggest lie. The biggest lie. But once you go through the gate, the thing that is astonishing is the length of the site. I don't know if it was just the weather that day, but I was looking and I couldn't actually see the end. It just sort of hazed into the horizon. You saw all of the places where there were the gas chambers going on and on and on, and then they just sort of faded into the background. Astonishing size of the place. I mean, I mentioned the vast number of sheds, but then when you go in and you visit one of the gas chambers, you see the dark walls, the shower heads up there, the nail scratchings on the walls. And then you go into the place where they preserved a lot of items that the Nazis were keeping in order to sell or use for other means. There were things like teeth, there were glasses, there were clothes, there were shoes, there was hair. But I also remember walking out and feeling incredibly humbled and sad, almost like I was lucky to be walking out of that place when only so many just dreamed of doing so and weren't able to. Everything I'd seen in history lessons was around me. in front of me. Nothing was a surprise to me because I'd seen pictures of it already, but that harsh, torturous reality surrounding me just made me feel sick to the core. This was the place where over 1 million people were brutally killed. Well, why am I telling you this? Well, because Auschwitz is a symbol of the reason why so many people were willing to give their lives during World War II. And crucially, anyone who shows you round that site, any guide that shows you round and explains some of the history of this place, always says that it's the most important thing that this site remains preserved so that it can bear witness as a physical reminder of the evil that humanity is capable of, as a warning sign to future generations so that it may never happen again. And we actually see this in scripture. In Joshua 24, it's a new start for Israel, a brand new start. And Joshua is laying out the foundations for the people. And he challenges them. He challenges Israel and says, do you know what? You're going to do the same thing again, aren't you? You're going to sin against the Lord and go your own way, just as your ancestors did. And they reply, no, we will serve the Lord. And this conversation kind of goes on and on and on like this until we get to verse 25. Listen to what Joshua says. And look at what he does. On that day, Joshua made a covenant for the people. And there at Shechem, he reaffirmed for them decrees and laws. And Joshua recorded these things in the book of the law of God. Then he took a large stone and set it up there under the oak near the holy place of the Lord. See, he said to all the people, this stone will be a witness against us. It has heard all the words the Lord has said unto us. It will be a witness against you if you are untrue to your God. Then Joshua dismissed the people, each to their own inheritance. A physical reminder of the promise they'd made, but also a physical reminder of where they had come from, their history, their sin-ridden history, pointing towards the path that they now endeavour to walk. But also in scripture, we don't just see this example of something that physically reminds you of your history, looking back. In Galatians 5, Paul talks about how it's easy for us to be blind to evil today. Galatians 5 verse 1 says, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. So Paul is explaining that Christ has come to set us free. But how we so often run back, we so often drift unawares back into those old habits, those sinful ways, sometimes without realising. And if we do that, we reject what Christ has done for us. And we reattach those chains to ourselves. It's very easy, isn't it, to look around us and see the evil in the world. But Paul is saying, actually, don't miss the evil that can so easily consume you from within. I don't know if you've seen recently on BBC Two a programme called Enslaved. It was a four-part documentary hosted by Samuel L. Jackson. And in this documentary, Samuel L. Jackson was hoping to uncover or expose the world behind the African slave trade, which Britain was a huge part of. And in the most recent episode, it showed a number of factors that led to the abolition of slave trade in Britain in 1807. And they were trying to work out why did this happen at this time. And one of the most biggest factors, one of the biggest influences on this happening was, they think, an advancement in technology. Because there came a time shortly before this where newspapers were able to print cartoons on a mass scale, good quality cartoons. And what the way that these were used is that people drew cartoons, examples of how slaves were being treated. And they said that British people were shocked to see what was happening in their country. Before this, it was a case of out of sight, out of mind. Something that was so normal to the British people, having slaves. Suddenly, the truth of it was uncovered and people rose up against it. For too many years, British people were blind to the evil of slavery. It was only when they were shown that it began to change their attitude, began to change. They understood, and that is how freedom then came about. Because they were shown, because they could see, they were no longer blind to the evil that was before them. Well, how does that apply to us as Christians? If we need to have a physical reminder that reminds us of where we've come from, and also something that reminds us not to be blind to evil in the world today, what can we look to? You might have already guessed it, but that's the cross of Christ. Why? Because the cross represents everything that I've been talking about up until this point. The first thing is that it represents evil, not just because it's one of the cruelest, most evil punishments in this world, but also because of the evil that was hanging on Jesus. That evil of the cross was directed towards God, and Jesus bore the weight of evil, of sin, on the cross. But secondly, it also reminds us of our blindness to evil. Remember that scene when Jesus is being crucified and people are mocking him. They're jeering Jesus on the cross. They saw this as a victory. Great, we're going to be rid of Jesus, finally. They gambled for his clothes. We read that he was placed between two criminals, but the people there saw it as three criminals being crucified. Jesus himself said while hanging on the cross, "Father, forgive them because they do not know what they are doing." They do not know what they are doing. The cross itself highlights how blind humanity can be to evil. The cross reminds us of our blindness to evil that we're all capable of. But the final reason why the cross is the symbol that we should look towards on a day like today is because it represents freedom. Because when I went to Auschwitz, the fact that I could go to Auschwitz, an empty Auschwitz, showed that actually this was a liberated Auschwitz. And in the same way, the empty cross represents the fact that Jesus died and rose again. He's not there. Jesus was rising again and saving us, liberating us from the bond of evil. Sin dissolves in the light of the cross. This is such good news. Jesus has paid the price of sin and set us free from the bonds of the evil. Jesus has made it possible for us to enter the presence of God. He's our forerunner that's gone ahead of us. He suffered on the cross, and now we can encounter God's manifest presence today. We are made white as snow. There is no greater freedom than the freedom of being in God's presence. And if you believe today that Jesus is Lord, that he died for your sins, and that was he was raised to life again, and you ask him to come into your life. That is how you accept freedom and welcome God's Holy Spirit into your heart. So to finish, why am I sharing this with you on All Days, on Remembrance Sunday? Well, because everything I've talked about highlights the reason why so many gave their lives in war. If we want to avoid having to fight on battlegrounds, in fields and on beaches, we need to first win the battleground in our hearts. And on that, we depend on Jesus. We depend on the cross. Evil longs to be forgotten. Satan's greatest weapons that he uses are anonymity, fear, and deception. And that's why Peter warns, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. That's 1 Peter 5, verse 8. When a lion prowls, if you see any animal documentary, you'll see its aim is to stay hidden. Evil longs to stay hidden. And if evil is forgotten, ignored, or not noticed, then it grows stronger and stronger without interruption. If no one stands up to evil, then evil will stand on us. Remember Paul's warning in Romans 12, 21, where he says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So let's not be deceived by evil today. Let's remember the cross where our Lord Jesus came and he died to free us from the bonds of sin. Let's not be blind to evil and remain bound to it, as Paul warns us in Galatians 5. Let's ask ourselves the difficult questions of how we live our lives, how we spend our time, how we spend our money. We can ask those questions whether you're 9, 39, 59 or 89. We can all consider, where is the hidden evil in our world? Let's ask God to show us where we might be blind to evil so that we might understand. Let's reach out for him. Be liberated by Jesus today. Be transformed by his Spirit and be the voice that calls out evil.
And so we come to our act of remembrance. The righteous live forever, and their reward is with the Lord. The Most High takes care of them. Therefore, they will receive a glorious crown and a beautiful diadem from the hand of the Lord, because with his right hand he will cover them, and with his arm he will shield them. Friends, let us remember in silence before God all those who have died in war. they shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them. We will remember them. Let us pray. Father of mercies and God of all comfort, we pray this day for all those who continue to suffer because of war. The widows, orphans, and all who are bereaved, those wounded, deaf, dumb and blinded, the shell-shocked, the refugees without home, work or country. Grant to them all your healing and strength, your help and consolation, and may it come through our Lord Jesus Christ and for his sake. Amen. Let's say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Beauty of thy peace. Breathe through the
come to break bread together at the Lord's table. So let's spend a bit of time in quiet, confessing any sin and receiving God's forgiveness and offering forgiveness where we need to do so. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful promise that if we confess our sin, you are faithful and just and will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen.
Amen.
And as we are unable to meet together in person, it's lovely we can meet using the computer. But I think it's important now that we remember that we are one body in the Lord Jesus as we're sharing the one bread. And it's great if we can pray for each other. So let's just begin to pray. Father, we thank you for the fellowship that we can share. Thank you that we're one body in you. And Lord, it's a sad week, particularly for some people who have lost loved ones more recently, and we ask you for comfort for them. We pray for anyone who's not well, for your healing power to be upon them. Lord, we pray for our own nation, for our government at this difficult time, for all those involved in healthcare in any way. We pray for those who are involved in education, teachers, lecturers, staff of different sorts. We pray for pupils, students. We ask, Lord, for your protection on our schools and colleges. We ask for wisdom and patience and your great peace to be with them. Father, we also pray for those whose jobs are insecure, that you would give them income they need and give them your peace. We pray for our armed forces. Father God, we pray for all those overseas at the moment serving in the name of our country, and for their families too, that they will also know your peace. And Lord, we pray for our world. We pray for the new US president. We pray for all leaders of nations, for integrity and wisdom and justice. And we pray finally for any Christian brothers and sisters who are suffering, particularly because of their faith. Lord, that you'll strengthen them and give them your Holy Spirit's power. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. And Paul wrote, "I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. He had given thanks, and he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, given for you.' And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup. So this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Now we're going to share the bread and wine. Dave, the body of Christ, broken for you.
Amen. Alison, the body of Christ, broken for you.
Amen. Dave, blood of God, Lord Jesus Christ, poured out for you.
Alison, may the blood of Christ keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. And through him we offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. We ask you, Lord, to send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work for your praise and glory. Amen.
Amen.
Above all powers, above all kings,
worship you, we thank you, we honour you, that you would give your life up for us, lay it down. We thank you that you were obedient right up to death. And Lord, we declare together that death could not hold you. Yes, you were laid behind a stone, but that stone was rolled away, and now you're alive, reigning forever. Lord Jesus, we worship you, you who have won the greatest victory of them all, the victory over all sin, all death and all evil. And we thank you that you've let us share in that wonderful victory, in that triumph. Hallelujah. And Lord, we ask you that our lives would reflect the glory of who you are, the glory of what you've done, now and always. Amen.
Amen. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you always, now and forevermore. Amen.